So we're very pleased to have Rick Winston and Michael Sherman with us tonight. Rick grew up in Yonkers, New York, and attended both Columbia University and the University of California, Berkeley. He arrived in Adamant, Vermont in 1970 and still lives there. Rick was the co-founder of the Savoy Theater in 1981 and one of the founders and one of the founders of the Green Mountain Film Festival in 1999. Rick is currently teaching film at the Montpelier Senior Activity Center and presenting programs on several film history topics for the Vermont Humanities Council. Michael Sherman is editor of Vermont History, the Journal of Vermont Historical Society, and a former director of the Vermont Historical Society. He is the co-author with Gene Sessions and P. Jeffrey Potash of Freedom and Unity, A History of Vermont, published in 2004. He is the author of articles and reviews on Vermont history, the humanities and public life, and the history of France in the 16th century, which fits in exactly with all the other stuff. Yeah. He undoubtedly knows why Vermont is Vermont. Yes. Michael edited and contributed to a volume on Vermont state government and administration since 1965, four books of essays on Vermont history, a book of essays on productivity, and three collections of essays on the humanities and public life. In 1988, Michael collaborated with Rick Winston and Richard Hathaway to plan and present a conference, Vermont in the McCarthy Era, co-sponsored by the Vermont Historical Society and Vermont College, which at that time was part of Norwich University. Would you please welcome Rick Winston and Michael Sherman.
Thank you. Yep. Okay.
Louder.
I haven't said anything yet.
I can't wait.
You just think he's talking.
This is the way it's going to go. I'm going to give a very brief introduction, how this book came to be, and just an overview of what's in the book. And then I will join Michael on stage for a discussion about the issues raised in the book, and then we'll throw it open for questions.
Talking.
Yeah, and the lights down. No, you yes, that's good for now. Yes. All right.
Better.
Looking in the back.
Okay. I should say this book was all the creative impetus for this book happened right here in Montpelier. I got to give a big thank you to my publisher, Stephen MacArthur, who's sitting in the second row. He stopped publishing. There's a little office right above Rite Aid. So it was edited in Vermont, in Montpelier, designed. We got to give a big shout out to Mason Singer of Laughing Bear Design. Copy edited, et cetera, et cetera. Anyway, a few words about how this book came to be. The title is Vermont in the McCarthy Era, but the book is called Red Scare in the Green Mountains. And Michael and I will talk about that terminology and the difference between those two phrases. This book really came to be because of my parents. My parents were New York City high school teachers, both of them art teachers, and they were political activists, union, very strong union people, especially in the New York City Teachers Union. And they got caught in what Philip Roth very eloquently described as, they were impaled on their moment in history. caught in a trap that ruined so many promising careers. Philip Roth was eulogizing his favorite high school English teacher in Newark, who, like my parents, had to deal with the Red Scare when it was happening. My father did lose his job. My mother, through an accident of timing, got to keep hers until retirement, and actually taught at the high school where Michael Sherman went. So this was something that Michael and I discovered early on. So the Red Scare was always part of my family background. I didn't realize how much it was till I was a teenager and really started thinking about these things and asking my parents very pointed questions. I moved to Vermont in 1970 and just very idly sort of wondered whatever happened here during that time. And it just remained idle speculation until I met Michael and Richard Hathaway, and the three of us collaborated on this conference, held over one weekend in June of 1988. And the panels that we put together for the conference kind of formed the basis of what subsequently became this book. For instance, the Vermont farmer who used the Fifth Amendment when questioned on his Red status, he turned out to be our keynote speaker. He was, in later years, much more well-known for being a China scholar, William Hinton, than he was for being a Vermont farmer. So one chapter in the book is about William Hinton, his remarkable family, and their history with Putney, Vermont, and the Putney School. His mother founded the Putney School, and two of the three Hinton children were very connected with the communist government in China. Alex Novikov was the one high-profile academic firing in Vermont. He was a biochemistry teacher at the University of Vermont, so we had a panel about Alex Novikov, and the chapter in the book focuses on Arnold Schein, who was Novikov's chief defender on the UVM faculty. That's David Levine's caricature of Henry Wallace, and we had a panel about the Henry Wallace campaign in 1948, where he ran on the Progressive Party ticket. And so the chapter in the book is about how the Burlington papers, most notably the Burlington Daily News, published by William Loeb, really viciously went after the people who supported Wallace. Rockwell Kent welcomes aid for Wallace from commies. Vermont was best known during the Red Scare era because our own Republican Senator Flanders was the one who introduced the censure proposal to the U.S. Senate. And there he is delivering papers to Senator McCarthy, and looking on is McCarthy's odious aide, Roy Cohn. If you want a little connection between then and now, Roy Cohn was 25 years old when he was McCarthy's protege. When Cohn was 50 years old, he was Donald Trump's mentor. So the chapter in the book that deals with Flanders is about Robert Mitchell, the editor and publisher of the Rutland Herald, and how Mitchell led the support of Flanders, as did many Vermont newspapers. And this is Paul Sweezy, who came to our conference to talk about the difference between what happened in Vermont and what happened in New Hampshire. Sweezy was a Marxist economist and a sometimes lecturer at the University of New Hampshire, and he almost went to jail for refusing to answer questions before the legislative committee in New Hampshire. The one who went after him was William Loeb, who moved from Vermont to New Hampshire to take over the Manchester Union later. So those were events at the conference that, that formed the basis for some of the writing in this book. Then there were events that we didn't get around to covering. A land sale involving the Asia scholar Owen Lattimore and other summer residents of Bethel and Randolph Center. The very cherubic looking, but a really crusading newspaper man, Bernard O'Shea, who held sway in the Swanton Courier up at the northwest corner of Vermont, the only self-proclaimed Democrat who ran a Vermont newspaper at the time. Many of you probably know Andrew Newquist Jr. in Montpelier. This was his father who ran against the right-wing Congressman, Senator Congressman Charles Plumley in 1946, and was red-baited and wound up losing that primary election. And my final chapter in the book deals with somebody who is sadly forgotten these days, William Meyer, who in 1958 became the first Democrat in 104 years to win a congressional seat. And I end that chapter with him losing his re-election campaign. He was beaten, actually, by Robert Stafford. And here's another connection from the past to the present. Meyer continued to run for office in the 60s, getting more and more disillusioned with the National Democratic Party, especially as the Vietnam War heated up. In 1970, he and a few others, including Bernie Sanders, founded the Liberty Union Party. So there's our connection with today.
That's Bernie?
Yes. Bernie, election night of his first mayoral victory.
Wow.
Okay, I think we can have the lights now.
I'm Michael Sherman. Rick fingered me as the interlocutor, not the interloper. Interlocutor has two meanings. One is a participant in a conversation, and the other is a person who asks questions. So I'm going to try to take both of those seriously. Just to start off as a kind of introduction about why, well, you've heard some of why Rick asked me to join here. That conference was really one of the first big events of my tenure as the director of the Vermont Historical Society. I can't remember exactly how it came to be, but Hathaway was on the Board of Trustees. Rick I had met already, and as you heard, we had this connection through his mother. When he, I think it was he, came with this proposal, he and Hathaway, two indomitable forces, came into my office and said, let's do this conference. There was no turning back. So I, in some ways, I guess I consider myself a godfather to this book. And the other part of it is that when Rick went on to continue his own research, he brought the chapter about the Bethel sale to me as editor of Vermont History. And we worked on that one together, and it got published in 2012. He subsequently brought another chapter, the Hinton family chapter, to me, which sadly didn't get published because he decided he had bigger fish to fry. But we did go through a first draft together. Mm-hmm. So I have a great affection for this book, and of course, great affection for Rick and admiration for what he's done here. So let's just talk a little bit about why this conference and why this book is important as both local and global history and national history.
Well, I always thought that this was a fascinating story with many different strands. And being kind of a newcomer to Vermont, I was interested in finding out some of the history and how, you know, Bernie Sanders clearly did not come out of nowhere.
and Brooklyn. Almost no one.
And I always thought this was a story that really should be told. And oddly enough, started work on it in earnest the second year of the first Obama term. And it, I think I met Stephen to discuss the publication of the book just as the 2016 campaign was heating up. So all of a sudden, the appearance of this book means something very different than if it had come out in 2008. And especially, as many people have noted, we have a president who is quick to use the terminology of McCarthy. He's accusing his opponents of McCarthyism and witch hunting, but he himself uses the techniques that are right out of the McCarthy playbook. So trying to understand what happened in Vermont during this era gives us gives the book a certain resonance that it wouldn't have had otherwise.
I'll add to that local, state and local history has a bad reputation among historians and in the public because it's thought of as being, oh, it's about nostalgia, about the good old days. And what sometimes gets lost is the fact that history takes place in places, not in a single place. And in this case, especially, it seemed to me that the local history, the state history, is a reflection on national history, and sometimes global history as well. And it's a reflection that shows both what's the same, how was Vermont similar to what was happening nationally, how is it different. Sometimes it can be congratulatory, sometimes not so much. And it also, I think, by focusing in on what we know, the place we know, the people we know, it sharpens the details of the history that we read in textbooks. And it gives a bit more life to the fact that history did not take place on the moon. It takes place in places that we know and inhabit. And that was what made that conference so compelling to me, and I think what makes the book so compelling.
Yes, I've often thought that a similar book could be written about every single state in the Union, because this was a national phenomenon, and it had different manifestations at different places, depending on who was the governor, who was the attorney general in New Hampshire. There was an attorney general who wanted to be a mini McCarthy. No such figure existed in Vermont. And histories have been written about, of course, what happened in Hollywood, what happened in Washington. There are several good books about what happened specifically in New York City, especially in education. A wonderful book by Ellen Schrecker called No Ivory Tower about how McCarthyism affected academia as a whole, using cases in point. But it felt like it was important to say, okay, this happened here, and this is why it happened here, the way it did. And it's just full of fascinating stories that are not nostalgic.
Well, some of them are, but most of them aren't. Let's talk a little bit about your title. You didn't title it Vermont in the McCarthy Era, 1946 to 1960. You titled it Red Scare in the Green Mountains. So talk about that choice.
Yeah, the conference itself was called Vermont in the McCarthy Era. But over the intervening years, as I've thought about this a lot more, I've come to really prefer the term Red Scare. Because for one, it's visceral, it's evocative, it connotes the fear that really gripped so much of the population. That's one reason that I like the term Red Scare. The other is it takes the focus away from McCarthy. And it's we have to remind ourselves at this late day, we look back at the 1950s, McCarthy's reign on the national stage was relatively brief. It started in the winter of 1950 and ended with a crash in the summer of 1954. So McCarthy, he had a bandwagon of his own that people jumped on, but he himself had jumped on a bandwagon that was already in motion with the beginning of the Cold War, the collapse of the wartime alliance between the United States and the Soviet Union. I think Harry Truman has to take part of the responsibility for that under pressure from right-wing Republicans that he wasn't, he was too soft on communism. Truman was the one who proposed the loyalty program that wound up driving so many people out of the U.S. government.
And in fact, it's an even deeper history because the first Red Scare comes at the end of Woodrow Wilson's years. In 1918, there is an extension of the Espionage Act, which started making it possible for people to get prosecuted and lose their jobs for speaking out against the government in any way. So this had a long history, and the Hugh Act, which started in the 30s.
Yeah. I was reminded that the American Civil Liberties Union started in response to what they call the first Red Scare during World War I and after.
Okay, let's go on to another question. Talk about the primary sources and the secondary sources that you used. to get what was easy to get, what was hard to get, and maybe what was your most interesting source?
I volunteered for the job of researcher when we did this conference in 1988, partially because I love looking at old newspapers. And there must be people here who have put in their hours with microfilm machines. It's really, it can take a lot out of your neck and eyes. So I went back to, I knew, for instance, that we were going to have a panel on Senator Flanders. So we knew those dates. So going back to those newspapers around that era and following the Rutland Herald day by day, that was very instructive. Looking at the letters to the editor is always really interesting. It was very difficult not to get sidetracked. Maybe some of you have had this experience too. That was the week that the Yankees and Phillies played in the World Series. And look what the Paramount Theater is playing. that was the primary sources. Once you find out that there are events, you know what roughly what era they took place in, you say, well, this is what the Burlington Free Press said, but let's see what Loeb was saying in the Burlington Daily News. And that was especially helpful when the whole controversy with Professor Novikov was happening, and which took place over the course of a few months. And William Loeb is putting his personal editorials saying this guy has to be fired right on the front page. It was a real relief to find, I found this with two newspapers, the White River Valley Herald, which is now the Herald of Randolph, and the Swanton Courier, both had bound issues that you could actually sit at a table and turn the pages. This was such a wonderful relief. And I had one of my great research experiences was walking into the Herald of Randolph and introducing myself to Dickie Drysdale, who only recently stopped being the editor, retired a few years ago. And I introduced myself, I told him why I was there, and he said, hold on a minute. And he went into his office and he came back with this big, thick manila folder, and he said, this is a folder that my father labeled Red Scare 1950. And I always knew that somebody would eventually want to see what was in it. So his father had saved every clipping from the Herald for that whole song. So during the conference, we were able to actually have panels with Robert Mitchell, Paul Sweezy, William Hinton, et cetera. But those people are just about all gone. And so I relied some on the children and in some cases grandchildren or nieces and nephews who had memories of this era and were able to help me, give me some wonderful old photos, and some of which got reproduced in the book. I had just a wonderful experience getting to know the children of Bernard O'Shea, some of them who still live in the Swanton area.
I should add that the we videotaped the conference. So if you go to the Vermont Historical Society, you can get access to those tapes. They're a little hard to hear because it was in the chapel at Vermont College before they did the acoustic. So a lot of bouncing stuff, and you must have had to work very hard to get that.
Well, actually, the conference was not only videotaped, but it was audio taped, and the sound quality on the audio tapes is a lot better. So that was another very good source going back to listen to these panels.
What about difficulties? Hardest sources to find.
Well, you saw that headline about Newquist denies any connection with communists. I'm sure more experienced historians also run into this problem. Here's a case where Newquist was running against Plumlee in the Republican primary. There was a story in the Barry Times that a group of a local meeting of the Communist Party endorsed Newquist. It was right there in print in the Barry Times. It took about a few weeks for other people to pick up on this story. First, a more conservative editor in Essex Junction, a paper called that doesn't exist anymore, called the Suburban List. And then, of course, it was picked up by the Loeb papers, and so all of a sudden, Newquist, you know, the headlines went from Newquist proposes this, Newquist proposes that, Newquist disagrees with Plumlee about this and that. It was all like, Newquist denies he is a communist. And I found a quote from Newquist in one of these articles saying, if they had only bothered to talk to me about what really happened at that meeting, this wouldn't have been a story. So there was no way of finding out what he meant by that. He didn't write anything. Andrew Newquist Jr. and Elizabeth, Andrew's junior sister, didn't have any memory of that. It was clearly Newquist Sr. felt that he was misrepresented in this article. I just couldn't, I went up against a brick wall there.
Another footnote, recently Andrew Newquist gave his father's papers to University of Vermont, so those are there. And you discovered that, or he told you about that when you were late stages.
Yes, you know, my originally the first chapter in the book chronologically was going to be the Henry Wallace campaign of 1948. I thought that was a really good place to start. that I ran into Andrew Newquist Jr. and he said, "Hey, did I ever tell you at the time my father was renovated by Charles Plumley? Oh, and by the way, I just donated all those papers to you." So I had to change my plans.
This is why when it says historians never finish their histories, they just abandon them. Because there's always something new turning up.
Yeah.
At least we hope so.
And what about the most enjoyable?
You could also talk about the least enjoyable. You could also talk about the least enjoyable if you wish.
I already talked about the least enjoyable. I was getting a neck strain at the State Library. And by the way, that is a phenomenal resource. It used to be in the Law Library in Montpelier. It's now over in Middlesex at the State Archives. They are incredibly helpful people there, and they have so many, I only barely scratched the surface of what they had. I think part of the most enjoyable was getting to meet some of these second generation people, and had just one person that helped me incredibly was William Hinton's niece, who's Carmelita Hinton's granddaughter, who is now sort of the keeper of the family archives down in Putney. And I said to her, "So I'd like to come down sometime and see the Putney School archives." Because clearly this woman, Susan Lloyd, 15 years earlier, had written the history of the Putney School. And so my friend, Carmelita's granddaughter, whose name is Marnie Rosner, said, "Well, I'll make some inquiries, but I don't think these archives actually exist. I've been after them over at the school for ages to actually put everything together in one place, but they," and she said, "I'll ask for you." And one thing led to another, and the archives intact were discovered in the basement of one of the dorms.
Oh my God.
And it was also one of these classic cases of, "Well, I've looked through all those boxes and I don't think I've found what I really need. But hey, what's that box back there? Maybe I'll look through that box." And the box was all the notes that this woman, Susan Lloyd, had taken for her history of the Putney School, which included minutes of the trustees meeting. You know, how do we deal with this? William Hinton is giving the school a black eye. He was testifying and refused 75 times to answer questions. And Carmelita Hinton saying, "My son did nothing wrong. I am not going to apologize for him. And if you don't like it, too bad." Quite a stance to take in 1954.
Okay, so you've talked somewhat about the media, the role of the media, and let's go into that a little bit more. And I'll just add a prelude. Most of us, I think, remember McCarthy from the Army McCarthy hearings. I mean, that was our first real view of him live, so to speak. But that wasn't the case in Vermont, because the Army McCarthy hearings went from April to June 1954. The first television tower went up in September 1954. So most Vermonters, maybe down way down in the south where they could maybe pick up an Albany station or something like that.
Yes, in fact, as an editor for many years at the Rutland Herald, Kendall Wilde, who was one of our panelists, as a young reporter, he broke the story that Flanders was going to give this earth-shaking speech on the floor of the Senate. And Wilde remembered all the reporters finishing their work for the day and going over to whatever hotel it was in Rutland, where there was the one television set in Rutland to watch the hearings.
I want to talk more about the role of the press here. How influential was it? How destructive was it? Especially the local papers, rather than this.
Yeah, this was a real. This research was very instructive about how strong the role of local newspapers can be, because there are a few stories that had some real heroes, to my point of view. And there were several editor publishers throughout the state, scattered throughout, and I found out about them, some of them because Bernard O'Shea up at the Swanton Courier, every once in a while would say, "What other editors are saying?" And during the Army McCarthy hearings, he ran a whole page of excerpts from different newspapers around the state, all supporting Flanders. So I found out about papers like the Woodstock Standard and the Addison Independent, and of course the Springfield Reporter is still around. And also going up to the Swanton Courier and at the Swanton Historical Society, where they have all these newspapers, and actually looking through it and seeing that. I got this feeling from O'Shea reading his writings that there was this very informal, maybe not so informal, network of like-minded people who are really devoted to their communities, devoted to their newspapers, and they had a very influential voice in the community.
They also, as you report in the chapter on Bethel, actually did their own investigation. They hired, you can talk a little about that a little bit.
Yeah, this, you saw the headline briefly about McCarthy charges land sale involving Lattimore. This was a situation that just kind of exploded onto the front pages nationally in late June of 1950. And it was very much centered on this teeny town of Bethel. And the nearest newspaper was in Randolph, where John Drysdale, Dickie's father, was the editor. And okay, well, so what do? You send a reporter out to look at the actual land deeds, and okay, here's what McCarthy is charging. Well, that's just not true. There it is. But he's got a small newspaper. He actually owned one in Bradford, too, called the Bradford Opinion. He's got a small newspaper. It only comes out once a week. So he calls up his friend Robert Mitchell. This is a story that Dickie told me, saying, you know, this is way too big for me to handle. And Robert Mitchell calls his friend at the Brattleboro Reformer, whose name is John Hooper, and Mitchell and Hooper together hire an investigative journalist from New York to come up to Vermont, and the result was a 6-part series running every day for 6 days on the front page of both the Rutland Herald and the Brattleboro Reformer. A little box on the front page, and then a full page, sometimes 2 pages, on the inside, saying, here's what really happened. And one result of this was that the controversy was over within a matter of weeks. I kept looking for more stories about this, and it just completely disappeared from the front pages.
I'll ask one more question, and then open the floor. And when we talked about this, Rick urged me to sort of give my own personal reflection on this. And the question really is, what makes this period and these events so enduringly interesting? I mean, McCarthy now is a trope, as you heard. It's kind of a metaphor that we use all the time. And so, you know, how did it get there? I mean, there are other bad things that have happened in our history. This one seems to have stuck really deeply. And I'll just offer my 2 experiences from my life that sort of made it indelible. The first was, like many of my generation, and I think this is a generation story, my first real political memory was watching the Army McCarthy hearings on television. It's the first thing that really stuck. I was 10, 9 years old at the time. My mother kept me home from school to watch them. And maybe I'm imagining this, but maybe it really happened. I did see the moment. I think I saw the moment when Welsh confronted McCarthy and said, have you at last no humanity? Whether or not I saw it at 9 or at 15 or something like that, those are powerful images. And they are part of the images of certainly my generation, and perhaps most of you, I think, I see in this room. So that was one, a very early one, and a very important one. One I think that suddenly made me realize I am in history. I am part of what's going on, and as I've reflected on that over the year, that is my real first historical memory, as well as my first political memory. The second one is a little closer to just personal stuff. I lived for 4 years in Appleton, Wisconsin. My wife Nancy and I went up there. I taught at Lawrence University. Appleton, Wisconsin was the hometown of Joseph McCarthy. He is buried in Appleton, Wisconsin. And more to the point, his first political position, he was elected a Wisconsin circuit judge in 1935. And was re-elected over and over again until 1944, left to go to World War II, came back, was re-elected a circuit judge in 1945, stayed there until 46 when he ran and was successful to the U.S. Senate, defeating the father. when we got to Appleton, we lived 2 blocks from the county courthouse. That was in 1974. The year before, there had been put up in the courthouse an enormous, larger than life-size bust in bronze of Joseph McCarthy.
No!
Yeah, what?
When was this?
This is 1974. Okay. And the funny story of it about that, I mean, it's horrifying to walk into this county courthouse and to see this enormous, I mean, really enormous bust, three times life-size. But the story that I heard and never verified was that the local paper, the Appleton Post-Crescent, when the ceremony took place the next day, the headline was, Bust of McCarthy Unevilled at his County Courthouse. Unveiled and unevilled, right? I don't know if the headline person got fired or what. But the second, there are three parts to the story. The second thing is that for all the years that Nancy and I and our two sons were born there, lived there, there were every year on McCarthy's birthday, there were graveside ceremonies. People would come from all over the country to pay their respects to Joseph McCarthy. Now this is in 1974 to 1978. I think it has been discontinued, but again, to realize that he didn't die when he died.
Yeah.
And that there was something deep in our culture that preserved him for all those years. And the third thing is that in 1976, but I'm not sure, the local newspaper, Post Crescent, and that would have been, I think, an anniversary of his, he was re-elected to the Senate in 1952, second term. The Post-Crescent printed in its newspaper the petitions that were signed both in support of him for second term and opposed him. There was a Joe Must Go group in Appleton. And they printed it on the front page of the newspaper, but of course it was reduced, right? So you had the big petitions. Everybody, there was a run of the stationery store for magnifying glasses. Everyone wanted to see who was on which side. And this was the sad part, it re-inflamed those conflicts. That this is so deep a story in American political history that it continued for another 20, 30 years to inflame people, excite people, and turn them against each other in a pretty small community. Appleton at the time was about 125,000 people. But it could still stir things up. So here we are with a book that is sort of coming on, passing along to the next generation of stories. So
right.
What is it that you think is in this his story that has such enduring importance?
I think you touched on it a little bit when you made a passing reference to Joseph Welch and the incredible drama where he challenged McCarthy in that way. And I think the inherent drama of these years is something that has lodged it in the American psyche. That is, that is, people were, in a way that maybe hadn't been quite so national or dramatic up to that point, had to take sides about whether they were going to submit to these feelings of fear and hysteria, or take a stand and say, I'm willing to go to jail rather than name, you want me to name people whose names you already have. I'm not going to do that. So, you know, the first big drama was, even, you know, 3 years before McCarthy was on the scene, was the HUAC and Hollywood hearings that resulted in the beginnings of the Hollywood blacklist. And so there was the spectacle of, it became not only a political issue, but a cultural issue as well.
And think of some of the films, Point of Order, which is a documentary, The Front, Woody Allen, Trumbo recently.
Yeah.
And on the other side, you know, there were people like Elia Kazan, who gave names and then sort of did his mea culpa with On the Waterfront, which is a great movie, but looked at it through a certain lens is really an apology for being an informant. So, anyway, it's, you know, every time you have people who are ready to stand on their principles and be willing to lose their jobs or go to jail, that is inherently dramatic. And it makes, you know, it makes people, younger people, wonder, well, what's going on? What are these principles that people are standing for? I have my own memory of the Arnie McCarthy hearings, not watching it on TV because we didn't get our first TV till it was over. But my older brother was one of the charter subscribers to Mad Comic Books. And in the summer of 1954, Mad did an astounding takedown of McCarthy. Presenting they said, well, they can improve these ratings with these hearings if they just turn it into a quiz show. and here's an idea for a quiz show. They called it, if you remember, that one of the central characters in the Arnie McCarthy hearings was Roy Cohn's friend, partner, whatever, David Shine. So they called this quiz show, What's My Shine? And you go back and look at this, and it's brilliant, and it's pretty courageous for the time.
Okay, so now it's your turn. Rick will call on people. I'll bring the microphone up so
should,
you can ask.
Should we turn the fan off?
Great evening, thank you, Michael. Just a bit of nostalgia. As many of you remember, in 1981, the Goddard, a full complement of the Goddard College adult degree programs were purchased by Norwich University for its Vermont College campus. And we immediately set about planning this conference, not but several years later, this conference, and another conference I just want to call to mind, and that was 1984. Ed Batome and Bob Belenke, founders of the Master's Program, of course, in 1984, planned the 1984 conference, and after the 1988 conference that Hathaway and you guys organized, I always thought both of these conferences should become a book. Little did I know that this one had long been underway. So I just want to thank you guys, and somebody should pick up on 1984. These both have the message, don't give in to fear. Don't give in to fear. And I think it's relevant today.
Thanks so much for putting this book together, and I'm glad to know there are tapes at the conference. Two very quick questions. One is, what got somebody labeled a communist, in addition to basically being the enemy of somebody who wanted to other them and get them in trouble, was if they were working for racial integration, if they were union organizers, and so forth. And I was wondering, so first question is, in the course of your research, did you find that the labeling was just, oh, communist, et cetera, or did they actually get into the reasons why here in Vermont? And second quick question, what really broke the fear over HUAC nationally was, well, part of it was WILF, the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, when they were called before HUAC, and that's a whole other story. But I saw in your book, the focus is on a number of men, and I was wondering, in the course of your research, were there any WILF members or other women, perhaps, that might have had some instructive stories as well? Thank you.
Okay, the first one. Charles Plumley, who was the right-wing congressman who Andrew Newquist Sr. challenged, going all the way back to the 30s, one of his major planks was control of unions by socialists and communists. You couldn't say the word union in his presence without, And it brought to mind a theory that my father always propounded, talking about his own experience in New York, which was the whole anti-communist boogeyman was an excuse by the powers that be to break the teachers' union in particular. And tying this into the racial justice system, I discovered a few years ago, reading a wonderful book by Marjorie Hines called Priests of Our Democracy. She really took apart the how the Red Scare affected the New York City teachers union. And she said that many of the teachers who might have been already left-wing to begin with,
how does this go on?
Found a lot of gratification and purpose in teaching in minority areas. And one of the things they discovered in teaching in minority areas was racist textbooks. And that was one of the planks of the union, that they wanted to get these textbooks amended. Well, it turns out that the history teacher who is the head of the team that wrote the textbooks was now the superintendent of schools in New York. So it was like he really had it in for the union. I'll just add one more thing that one of the characters in this Owen Lattimore Bessel story was an anthropologist who had a summer home in Bessel. He had been a former Arctic explorer named Vilhelmur Stefansson. And there's a book called Threatening Anthropology by David Price, which says that the FBI and then HUAC went after anthropologists in particular, because they found that because of their training, they had theories about racial equality.
Yeah.
So they were always joining these organizations in favor of racial justice that were communist fronts, supposedly. And I'll just get in a plug for Dorothy Canfield Fisher, who was a great heroine during this time and did a lot of writing defending people who were under attack. You know, I was hoping to find some more women in this story, but you know, they were not in public office, they were not running the newspapers, and
I'll just add to that, but it was the teachers' union here, and that would mostly have been women. In the 1950s.
Yeah.
The teachers' union really led the charge against Plumlee. They said, tell us who do you think they're, give us names. You know, he actually turned McCarthyism on its head because he said, I have here 100 and whatever names, you know. And so those teachers were taking a big risk in their own communities, and speaking through the union. And then, of course, Dorothy Canfield, who wrote very often and was very well known and very much respected in the state. So she was a major voice in speaking up.
Well, I'm just wondering, listening to this, it so resonates with what's happening today. I'm wondering if, since Joe McCarthy has got such a historical hold on people, I'm wondering if that same segment that, you know, goes to his gravesite and that are the same people who were so angry that they put Trump in power. And, you know, we're talking about very similar eras in history. And I'm just wondering if you think that McCarthyism sort of was underground all this time and is now surfaced again with Trump.
A friend of mine is fond of saying, once you turn the rock over, they're always there. I think that if you go back, Andrew and I were in New York last year at the Museum of the City of New York. We just happened on this exhibit about the anti-immigrant riots in New York in the 1830s and 40s.
Yeah.
You know, this has been such a strong strain in American cultural life. Fear of the other, economic fear, cultural fear, and you see the, you know, as long as there is fear, there are politicians who are ready to take advantage of it.
In the 1970s, I think it was a graduate student named Martin Turow, you know about this, did a survey in Bennington. It's a very flawed survey. He only interviewed men. He only interviewed industrialists, merchants, you know, urban people, no farmers. But the interesting, he found a lot of support for McCarthyism then and still when he did this. And when he asked why, came the answer, well, he's standing up for the little guys.
Oh.
You know, government has lost touch with us. And McCarthy, okay, and I think that's the key. We're talking about populism, you know, this new populism. Populism has been around for a long time. The first big populist movement was in the late 19th century, right after, you know, post-Civil War. And it's there all the time. It's the sense that there are people who are forgotten by the powers that run the state. And then there's a guy who stands up to the government. McCarthy was really standing up to the government, especially when he got to the Army McCarthy heroes. He was challenging Eisenhower. He was challenging the Army, for goodness sake. He was challenging the whole deep state, is what we call it now. And that really has, and had, and I think continues to have, its appeal. So, Emma had a question.
I am a radio listener. I don't even listen to it, but I keep it on all day. But I would like to know if radio played any role with a regular population that didn't read newspapers, but keep the radio on all day. And did they react to
You know, that was another area that I just didn't really get to explore. I got as far as talking to Ken Squire at WDUV, who said, you know, no, we were just doing farm news and, you know, the Trading Post and the Old Spire. And, you know, I think the I didn't hear about any influential radio people locally. There might have been stations that carried people like Fulton Lewis Jr. And other right-wingers.
But they were very important radio, so Kaltenborn, who was very rapidly anti-communist, and Walter Winchell, who had deep all the men at sea. But in the post-war period, he also became very much a supporter of. And they, you know, it's harder to get that because I think this is the age before the Nielsen ratings. The Nielsen ratings came in fairly early in the media era, but I think it's before they started. So it's a little hard to be able to track how popular and how influential they were. I mean, I've seen articles about other things where Winchell and Kaltenborn take to task the left-wing politics going on around here. That's one way of indirectly getting at that question.
One more question, I think. Just go ahead, Bert.
Thanks for doing this. Is the story complicated, or should it be complicated, and this is for both of you, by the fact that what was going on in the Soviet Union at that time, and also for decades, was really horrible?
That is a complicated question. And I know that there are a lot of people on the left who started hearing about what was really happening in the Soviet Union. Some of them got very disillusioned right away and left the party. There was an incredible exodus around the Nazi-Soviet pact. But then there were others who felt that, well, we've cast our lot with our idealism that this is going to be a better world somehow, and we can't give J. Edgar Hoover and Joe McCarthy the satisfaction of saying you were right. And so I think it's you know, somebody said you can't let fear take you over. I think there's also a kind of a warning about true believerism of any stripe. I think a lot of people got, because of their own idealistic beliefs, got a very rosy picture of the Soviet Union and signed on to that program. There's no doubt about it that there were terrible things that were happening, many of which did not become public until years later.
I think you also have to remember that Russia was an ally in World War II, and when the Battle of Stalingrad, you know, there was great affection and great admiration for them holding out against the Nazis and you know, sustaining all those losses. So there was a sense of heroism about the Soviet Union that I think attracted people and then held on to them. And then I think Rick is right that afterwards people, you know, as more and more started coming out, some people just didn't believe it. And they said, oh, it's just propaganda. And remember Will Rogers' famous thing, I've been to the future and it works. I've seen the future and it works from a generation earlier. So there was that view about the Soviet Union as well as the great enemy. There was a question way in the back. Would that be our last one?
No. Steve is the last one.
My question is with discernment, subtlety, and mythology. you guys would give us some background. But first of all, thank you for the references about Bud O'Shea and Dick Hathaway. I went to elementary school in Swanton. As a fifth grader, I was a Swanton Courier paper boy. And in Dick Hathaway's last years of his life, I was his personal assistant. But discernment suddenly mythology. The oldest form of communism in human story is monasticism. In monasteries, there's no private property. It's all held in common, point one. Point two, in Vermont, from the 1900s through the 1950s, every county had a dairy cooperative. The workers owned the means of production. The survivors are Cabot and the St. Albans Cooperative. Used to be a huge one in Barrie called Granite City Cooperative. But every county had a dairy cooperative where the workers owned the means of production. Where dairy cooperatives and monasteries attacked by McCarthyism, and if not, why not?
Not very many monasteries in the United States. I don't know that he ever attacked the dairy. I mean, he was from Wisconsin, the dairy state. You know, you start attacking the dairy industry in Wisconsin, you're in serious trouble. So he may have kept hands off because, I mean, above all, I think of McCarthy as an opportunist. He saw which way things were going and he got on that bandwagon. He didn't necessarily go into Congress as an anti-communist candidate. It was something that he came to at some point and saw that it was working, and so he pushed it as far as he could. So I'm not sure that it was that he was motivated by ideology, which may be the other answer about the monasteries. I mean, there aren't many monasteries in the country, but that's a whole, that monasteries are communities held together by a theology, certainly, and a particular ethic. It's a hard one to attack. He was Roman Catholic himself, so hands off. And I think that may be, if there is any answer to that, I think it may be in there.
I just had a quick question about your interactions with Tony Hiss, and if you might share a little of that.
The question was about Tony Hiss, the son of Alger Hiss, who Tony Hiss wrote a very nice blurb for me when I sent him a copy of the book. Tony Hiss's father, Alger Hiss, was he worked in the State Department.
Yeah.
So he was accused of running a spy ring, an espionage spy ring in the late 40s. This is how Richard Nixon first got his big headlines. And he was convicted not for espionage, but for perjury after three separate trials. Tony Hiss wrote a wonderful memoir called The View from Alger's Window. And it was about his memories of being a kid and having his father in jail, the letters that would come to him. And we first got in touch because I wanted to reprint part of an excerpt from this book. His family had been coming to Peacham since the mid-30s. And during one of the trials, I forget which one, the family thought the trial was taking place in the summertime, and the family thought it would be better for Tony to not be around all this controversy. They sent him to Peacham to just stay with friends that they had made in the community. And Tony wrote very eloquently about how welcomed he was in Peacham and how important this was to him as a little kid, to feel like he belonged somewhere. And he said, his experience in Peacham gave him his first inkling that that McCarthyism was not going to go down well with a lot of Americans. That these people were not afraid to say, "Well, I may disagree with what your father says, but you're kind of part of our family. So we never met, Tony and I, but we have got a few emails.
I think someone's here from Bear Pond to sell books, right?
Yes.
So we should stop now, because I'm getting these snobs. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Rick, for this book.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you to Michael, Rachel, Samantha, Tom.